Welcome to another presentation about the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. Mainstream geologists seem satisfied to attribute the origin of the Carolina Bays to thermokarst or to eolian and lacustrine mechanisms while ignoring the fact that the Carolina Bays and the Nebraska Rainwater Basins have mathematically elliptical geometry in that their orientations converge by the Great Lakes, which are features associated with impact structures. Of course, many Carolina Bays are not elliptical. Their form depends on the characteristics of the terrain on which they are found and on the terrestrial forces that they experience after their emplacement. Research about the Carolina Bays is not being conducted in universities or research institutions. It is being conducted on YouTube by people who are inquisitive and are trying to figure out how nature works. Most of the recent work on the Carolina Bays has relied on the infrastructure provided by Michael Davies, which consists of a LiDAR visualization tool for Google Earth and measurements for about 74,000 geological features in spreadsheet format. Today's presentation is based on a comment that Chris Cottrell from the Dabbler's Den made on David Swanson's YouTube channel. Chris said, "Hey Dave, I need you to check something out. At the 12-minute mark, you talk about smaller launch projectiles dropping off due to air friction. I've come across groupings of land features that I've dubbed high terrace pockmarks and valley pockmarks only because I thought they may be related to the Carolina Bays, but obviously not the same thing. Your visualization tools and calculations may prove they are indeed related. Let me know what you think." Chris Cottrell was referring to the features illustrated here. The valley pockmarks are located in Indiana on a valley surrounded by hills, whereas the high terrace pockmarks are located in Ohio in mesas bounded by steep slopes. David replied, "I've looked at the valley pockmark area and I think it could very well be associated with the event that formed the base. Many of those pockmarks appear circular, like high-angle impacts, but when looked at closer, some have cross-sections closer to low-angle impact or perhaps even bounces. I made a short video answer that I'm posting soon. To use this data in the type of analysis, I would need bearings. I will be thinking about how to analyze these further." David Swanson posted a video titled, "My Thoughts on Dabbler's Den Valley Pockmark Question." David marked transects across some of the pockmarks and examined the inclination of the terrain along these lines. Dave was able to show that even though the pockmarks look circular, the cross-section of the terrain was asymmetrical and seemed to be consistent with impacts at shallow angles. Examination of the transects of several pockmarks seemed to confirm this observation. This asymmetrical inclination is what would be expected of an oblique impact on a viscous target where the depth of the cavity is later reduced by viscous relaxation. David Swanson said that further analysis would need bearings. This is true. In this image, I have emphasized the transects used by David. The azimuth of the first pockmark examined by David is approximately 248 degrees. Extending the azimuth leads toward Akron, Ohio, which is about 111 kilometers or 69 miles south of Lake Erie. To find the direction from which the pockmarks were made will require drawing transects with different bearings through each pockmark to identify the bearing that has the greatest difference in slope. Since many Carolina Bays converge at Lake Michigan or Saginaw Bay, it would be important to consider bearings from these locations when examining the slopes of the pockmarks, but the determination should be objective and not be biased by preconceived notions. It is also important to consider that the pockmarks could have formed from thermokarst. The map by French and Miller shows the speculative limit of permafrost during the last glacial maximum, and it seems to cover the locations of the pockmarks in Indiana and Ohio. The fact that the boundary of the permafrost is called speculative means that nobody knows for sure. Melting permafrost could have caused the ground to sag to produce the pockmark features, but thermokarst does not create inclined slopes of the basins in a specific direction, so a consistent direction of the slopes of multiple pockmarks could be used to rule out the thermokarst origin of the pockmarks. Overlaying the map from Google Earth with the ice coverage published in 2023 by Wickert et al., we can see that the pockmark areas in Indiana and Ohio were never covered by ice even during the last glacial maximum. However, the terrain would have experienced substantial flooding and water erosion when the glaciers advanced and retreated. Some geologists would say that the pockmarks could be kettle lakes. Kettles are formed when blocks of dead ice are left behind by retreating glaciers or by receding flood water. The ice becomes buried in the sediment, and when the ice melts, it leaves a depression called the kettle hole that often fills with water. As in the case of thermokarst, a consistent direction of the slopes of the pockmarks could rule out kettles as the origin of the pockmarks. Our knowledge about the Carolina Bays is increasing thanks to the hundreds of hours spent by inquisitive professionals and citizen scientists looking at the LiDAR images provided by Michael Davias. The contributions of Chris Cottrell and David Swanson are really appreciated. Thank you for joining me in the investigation of the Carolina Bays and the Younger Dryas Cataclysm. The Carolina Bays should not be neglected. Ask your geology professors to discuss the Carolina Bays because they are the most prevalent geological structures in the Atlantic coastal plain. There's a link to the LiDAR visualization tool in the description of the video. My book about the Carolina Bays is available at Amazon. Please subscribe to my YouTube channel to be notified of future videos about the Carolina Bays and other scientific topics.